So we are still in 2 Peter, in 2 Peter chapter 2. We have a couple of verses today. Last week we talked about how destructive false teachers are, and it destroys many, many, many souls. Probably the worst, you know, we think about weapons of mass destruction, right? And we're scared. And we even go to war because of things like that in the physical sense. But the worst weapon of mass destruction is a false teaching in terms of God, in terms of the Bible. When you teach falsely, there's millions and millions of souls that follow those teachings. And we know, when we read in 2 Peter 2 verses 1 to 3, that they are very destructive. And we talked about that last week. But, you know, sometimes we see that those false teachers are very successful. No doubt about it. You turn on the TV and people preaching the gospel of prosperity. And then, you know, God, we're sons of the King, of the King of Kings, right? So we have to be prosperous. You're not made to be, you know, poor or whatever. They say so many things in those channels and those false teachers. And they make money as well. They be flying, and they know how to excuse it as well too. They justify that very, very smart, very sleek, if you will. And they get the money from people that are weak, that are not strong in the faith, and that unfortunately, as we learned last week, the way of the truth is blasphemed because of those people. And right now we're losing a lot of people to those teachers. Like I say, you turn on the TV and you see all these channels promising, you know, riches in the world and all the other stuff that we see on a daily basis. And it's just sad when we know how destructive it is, how many souls are lost thinking they're doing the right thing. This is serious. We don't see it because they speak so well. And we'll learn that later in this letter. I mean, they're so persuasive and just speak so pretty. That's why I like to say they speak pretty. They sound good. They motivate people. People want to hear that. Right? We want to hear it too. But we know, we understand from the Bible that it is not all, you know, good news. We are going to go through tribulations. Our faith in God will be tested. And those tests are not easy sometimes. They're hard, and they, you know, they can take us down. And if we're not strong in the faith, and have strong brothers in the faith, and sisters in the faith to help us, to pick us up, it's hard. So it's not as they paint it, but it's destructive, and we know that. But we see that, and sometimes we wonder, why do this prosper so much? Look at this pews empty. Now we'll turn the TV, like I said, in one of those channels, hundreds of thousands of people. And you know, you could get discouraged if you don't know what we're about to look in today. Because he said last week, he said in verse 3, we close in verse 3, he talked about by covetous, by greediness, greed, by being greedy, they will exploit you with deceptive words. For a long time, their judgment has not been idle, and their destruction does not slumber. So we seen that they prosper, unfortunately, and sometimes we can think of course, nothing is going to happen to these people. They're doing the right thing. What's going on here? We're trying our best to be faithful to the Word of God. We're trying our best to go by the letter, to go, you know, and walk in the right way, not turning left, not turning right. But what's going on? Well, not so many people want to hear the right things. Not so many people want to hear the truth of the Bible, not your truth. Because now truth nowadays is people say is subjective, but it's not. Okay, it's objective. It's the truth that we have in the Bible that will determine where you and I will spend eternity. And we were talking about that. I was listening to something, and it made me thought about the difference of the outer person and the inner person. And we always thinking about the outer person, the body, the flesh, because we are in the flesh. And we have to be careful not to lose sight. Because what's moving this body is not the body itself, it's the soul. It's that inner person that we want to work on every single day. Not every week, every Sunday, every Wednesday. Every single day we need to be working on our inner person, exercising, eating right. Same things you do with the body, with the physical body. We're to be doing that, right? So we can get discouraged. But guess what? Here in this little passage of scripture that we have in 2 Peter 2 and verses 4 through 9, Peter talks about the doom, the destination of these false teachers to encourage us. And it's a perfect example. We know we always talked about how the Old Testament it was written for our examples. And you can see that there's two key verses in the New Testament, 1 Corinthians 10. And you can read the whole chapter, but right about around verses after Paul talks about Moses and the example, how they were taken out of Egypt, delivered from bondage, and baptized through the water and the cloud and the rock, and Christ was with them, and so on. Same thing that happened to us when we believe, right? He says, now these things, all the things that happened in the Old Testament, became our examples to the intent that we should not lust after evil things as they also lost it, and not become idolaters as were some of them. And he continued to say that. He said the same thing to the Romans. And you know this verses, Romans chapter 15. Romans 15, this verses should be in your mind at all times, because the Old Testament is very valuable. We can learn a lot of things to do and a lot of things not to do. Now, Romans 15:4 says, for whatever things were written before were written for our learning, that we through the patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. He says, so this is right here. Sometimes you say, okay, I understand that. But Peter used that beautifully here. All he did was he went back to the Old Testament and he used the things that were written, and he uses for our example the same thing that we're to do. And he only used about three examples here, but we have so many other examples in the Old Testament that we can learn from. But Peter did it beautifully here. And he started by saying, listen, God, don't get discouraged if these people don't repent, because God doesn't want anyone to perish. Just like us, we don't want anyone. I don't want to perish, and I don't want anyone to perish either, because that's God's heart. That's his goal, that all come to repentance. But we know that is not how it is right now. People are still doing their own thing. They want to, you know, they think they're created. They created the world. They created themselves. We didn't. We were created by God, and he has the right to tell us what to do and not to do for our benefit. But when we think about that, you know, we have three examples here. And the first one he uses is the angels. And you'll see the sequence. It makes sense when you really think about it. Peter starts by the angels. The angels, if you go to verse 11 in 2 Peter 2, you'll notice that he says in verse 11, he says, whereas angels who are greater in power and might. So angels are greater than we are. No doubt about that. If I said that before quoting a verse, you might have thought that I was making it up. But I'm not. The angels are powerful. They're strong. We were studying about Balaam and Balak, right? And he uses that example here later too. But he when he saw the angel, what did he do? He just bowed down and was scared to his death, because he saw how powerful that creature was. And he had a sword, and I couldn't imagine what he felt. But you know how you feel when you find someone that, for example, the cops, you know, they got the power, and you get all scared. You say, what did I do? But these angels are more powerful in power and in might. And Peter starts by saying what they did, this angel who sinned. And we don't have all kinds of details if you want to know about what did they do. What, you know, we know that they sinned. We know Jude, remember when we studied Jude, he said that they left their place. They crossed the line. And God had, we see, God, he said, he did here, he said, but he cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness. There was no mercy for these angels. When I was reading this, I thought my mind went back to Job. If you read Job chapter 1, you're going to know why I say that. The angels had access to God. They spoke to God. God asked them where you guys have been. Remember that? Job chapter 1. So they have access to so many things. They're different. They don't have a body like we do. And for they different, their excellency is great, their power, their might. And that, what does that tell us? That tells us that, well, no matter how great we think we are in this world, in the flesh, and we know the Revelation said that from the greatest to the least, we all going to be one before the judgment seat of Christ, before God to be judged. So no matter how great we are, actually the greater you are or you think you are, the greater the punishment, the greater the judgment as well. James talks about that. Do not become teachers, many of you, chapter 3. Why? Because you will receive stricter judgment. So you see the thing there, that the angels is the highest creature. If you are creatures of God, when they sin, what happened to them? God cast them down. No mercy. We do receive mercy. We have an advantage on that sense. But he cast them out to hell. In the word hell there, I'm not saying it's wrong, but it's not the word. It's two words for hell. One is Gehenna or Gehenna, which means the actual hell, the place where it's prepared for the angels by God, not for humans, by angels. But there's Gehenna and there's Tartaros or Tartarus, however you pronounce that. There's two. The Tartaro words is the one here in the original language, and that's the place where people go. It's a section of Hades, if you want. Everyone goes to Hades when we die. But there's two sections. You learn that in Luke chapter 16. There's two sections of Hades. There's paradise and there is the torment place. And this is that place that he's talking about, that God cast these angels down into the chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment. Just like, you know, an example for us, if we don't follow God, if we don't do what he says, that's where we will go, waiting for that great day of judgment. Now, he also moves on to the world, the ancient world. And this is all before Noah, before the flood. A great example in Genesis. You can go and read and learn about it. But he says he did not spare the ancient world, but save Noah. One of eight people. One of eight people. A preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. So the first thing that you say here, it doesn't matter how great you are, right? Whether you think you're an angel, because some people think they're angels, but whether you think you're an angel, or whether there's so many people in this world, I don't know, I try to look for the number of people in the population in the Noah's time, and there's so many different opinions. I know there were millions. There was a lot of people at that time. That didn't matter. The wickedness was so great, and only one person found grace in the eyes of God. And that's what we need to understand, and to make, for us to make it into heaven, it says what? Pursue holiness. Without which, what it says? It's the Hebrew writer. Without which no one will see God. Without holiness, without being out of that wicked world, out of those things that are going on in the world. And we were speaking about that this morning as well. How can we separate? How we sanctify to be away? No, it doesn't matter what's going on in the world. However many people there is, we got about 7 billion people right now. Way more than the, back in the times of Noah. But it doesn't matter. We know clearly that Christ says that narrow is the way that leads to life, and only a few find it. So we are in that race to be part of those few. We want to be part of those few, because unfortunately we know that many will go to the wide and easy way, and then that's not a good thing. So we have to be careful. Doesn't matter how many people, this guy found grace in the eyes of God. What was he doing? And it's an example. We get negative examples and we get positive examples. Noah is that positive example. What was he doing? He was a preacher of righteousness. And many, many things, you don't even hear him preaching. And we know because the Bible says so, right? He was a preacher of righteousness. But we know that not only what we say speaks about us or speak to other people, but it's also what we do. So what he did was obeying God. People saw him, and I'm pretty sure people were asking, Because if you see somebody building a boat just in the middle of nowhere, yeah, I know you're going to stop by and ask some kind of questions. And I'm pretty sure he preached to them. He said, well, God had it. So we have to do this so we can get in there and not die when the flood comes. And I'm just, you know, making that up basically. But I can imagine a conversation like that. You know, you see somebody building a boat, you go. And I'm pretty sure not only did he preach and told them, but the way he acted, how he fulfilled every single commandment God gave him. He told him what kind of wood. He told him the measurements. He told him everything to the last detail. And guess what he did? He did as God commanded him. Every single detail was followed. Even the kind of wood. And I'm pretty sure there was all kinds of woods around, but he followed. So he was preaching righteousness. Same thing that we have to do as we live in this world and as we walk in our daily life is be preachers of righteousness because of what? Sorry. Because the flood came on what? On what did the flood came and kill? The ungodly people. So if we're living godly, there is some hope. And we can start seeing it here. There is hope if you're living godly before God. All that means is doing the right thing, doing the things that God wants us to do, that are written in the scriptures. Now, he moves on to a more closer example to us. And we'll learn in the next chapter, chapter 3 in 2 Peter, that this here is very close to us. Because this here is what's actually going to happen to this world right now. The one we're looking at. The one we're living in. He says, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes. He says, condemn them to destruction, making them an example to those who afterward would live ungodly. So, this is an example, and you know the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. If you know it's back in Genesis, I can tell you the chapter if you want to read it. But you can go to Genesis chapter 6. That's Noah. You can go to Genesis chapter 18, 19. That's when you start seeing the whole thing unfolding of how God saw the world so wicked after Noah. This is after Noah. So Genesis 18, 19, you'll see that example. But it's you see there that because of the ungodly, because of what those people were doing, it's pretty much the same thing that we're doing. This world is doing now. Sexual immorality. Drunkenness, carousing in the daytime, in the daytime, doing all kinds of evil things, you know, in the daytime, not even at dark, not even hiding, out there in the open, just like the same thing we're seeing right now. And this is the example, like I said, for us. Because when we read, you'll see when we read chapter 3, you'll see why I say that and why Peter says that, that this is our example. This world will become ashes. This world, the Bible says, he says, this world and everything in it, everything that is built into this world will become ashes. And there will be no place for it. But we, you see what we have when we act right, right? So he put this as an example. But now again, we get another positive example. Another man, one man, Lot, he found grace in the eyes of God because he was a righteous man again, doing the right thing. If you go to verse 8, you know, he tells you he delivered righteous Lot. That's the first righteous. You find that like 3 or 4 times here. He says, he delivered righteous Lot who was oppressed by the filthy conduct of the wicked. And then in parenthesis, he says, for that righteous man dwelling among them tormented his righteous soul day to day by seeing and hearing, not only seeing but also hearing their lawless deeds. And that's, I know you feel like that sometimes, because I do. I feel like that sometimes when I'm at work and I'm in the midst of coworkers, the things as they speak, it's like I used to have the lunch bunch or something. It was a group of people that go to lunch every day 11:30. And I used to sit with them. I don't sit with them anymore because And they know, because many of the time they were there speaking and saying things, they know I'm a Christian. I don't hide that from anyone. I'll make sure I put it out. And so when we were there, you know, they were still speaking, cursing, doing all kinds of sexual things. And there was, oh, I'm sorry, pardon my French and things like that, you know. And yeah, I know you heard that. But it's like, I can't stay here. So now I go at 11. I go to lunch at 11. Because I couldn't take it anymore. And I know you guys probably feel like that. People are evil. People that don't have God, unfortunately, you know, they're evil. They slander you. They try to put you down, whether it's at work, whether it's at school, whatever you go, even driving. You go driving and people are driving like they don't care about anyone. And we see that every single day, okay? We see that happening right now. And if you read that story of Sodom and Gomorrah, you'll see that homosexuality was one of the greatest things happened there. They saw the angels that came in, and if you want to read it for yourself, do it. They saw the angels, the men coming in, and they wanted to be with them. They wanted to know them in a sexual manner. So we know why they went there to destroy those cities. Okay, and we see that happening right now. I mean, thousands of people out in the street protesting because they're scared they're going to take their rights away, LGBT and all this other good stuff, right? Or bad stuff, let me say bad stuff, right? And you, unfortunately, you know, you don't want to be, you know, you don't want to be mean to these people. You don't want to be, you know, evil back to them. You want to pay on the other way, with righteousness, with blessings and things like that. But you know, our souls, and if it's not happening to you, I cannot know that, because you only know yourself. If when you see this stuff, your soul is not oppressed, it's not sad, it's not, you know, down and just looking at these people basically walking into this place that God has prepared. And I'm telling you, God did not prepare this place that He talks about here. He did not prepare this for you and I. For any human being, it was not prepared for them. It was prepared for these angels that sinned, as we read here in verse number 4. Not for you and I. Not for anyone in this world. But we see that in our souls are vexed, like he says, oppressed. We suffer, and we should be. If we're not suffering, well, that might be a symptom of something else. So we have to take care of that. If, like I said, you only know yourself. I know me, and you know yourself. So if you're not tormented, if you're not oppressed in your soul when you see that, well, we have to do some praying, right? But we still got to do some praying for these people, because what's coming is not pretty. It's not pretty. Many people don't understand that. Many people don't understand what's coming, what that place after you die and after you pass on from this world, that place that you go is permanent. There's no more doing. There's no more repenting. There's no more. It's what you do now. And we see here in verse 9 that, yes, we are oppressed. Yes, we're sad. Yes, we get discouraged sometimes, or disappointed. I don't want to never get discouraged. You can get disappointed, but don't get to that point. Try not to. Find somebody, pray. Don't get to the discouragement. That's not a good word. We get disappointed, but we don't want to get discouraged. Why? Well, read verse 9. That's all you got to do. You got to read the Bible. Read verse 9. He says, then the Lord knows. He knows. Not only does He know who are His, but He knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust under punishment for the day of judgment. And especially those who walk according to the flesh, in the evil desires of uncleanness and despise authority. And I'm already passing verse 9, but here's what we need to understand. Okay? Doesn't matter what you're going through, whether it's a temptation, whether it's a trial, whether it's anything that you're going through, a sickness, disappointing, whatever it is that you're going through, you know and you're sure that God knows how to deliver you. He will, if you stay faithful. That's the condition, of course. If you are godly, if you're acting right, if you're doing what God says, which is not that hard, right? John says, you keep my commandments, which are not burdensome. If we're doing what we the best we can to live godly in this generation, in this society that we're living in, God knows how to deliver you. He knows how to deliver us. And those people that oppress you, whether they do it directly or whether they do it not directly, indirectly, God will reserve them for the punishment they deserve. And we're not to be happy about that, of course. I don't want that to happen to anyone. I don't want it to happen to me. But I don't want that to happen to anyone. And I hope that everyone out here in this gathering have the same heart. You don't want people to go to that place, to be reserved for that punishment that we will get if we don't obey God. So what I propose this morning is that if you have obeyed the gospel, if you have believed in Jesus Christ, if you have repented of your sins, of all the lawlessness or transgressions, breaking God's law, that's what sin means. If you repent from that, if you have repented from that, and you have confessed Christ, you have made that great confession, yes, Christ is the Son of God, the Christ, the anointed one, the promised one. I believe that. You repent, you're baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. If you have done that, of course, take encouragement from these verses. Look at the negative, but don't concentrate on the negative. Concentrate on the positive. God knows how to deliver us. If we stay faithful, He will be with us until what? Till the end of days. Whether it's your ends of the days or He returns, He will be with us. He is with us. And the people that are doing whatever they're doing to us or to other people, they will pay the price if they don't repent. They will. We have to trust God. So if you have obeyed the gospel, continue to be faithful. Continue to hold on to godliness, to righteousness, to being just. It's the same thing, justice. Do justice. Do the right thing before God and before people. And we'll be together with Him in eternity. Now, if you have not obeyed the gospel, of course, we encourage you to do that today. By what? Knowing that Christ came to this world. He was killed, crucified, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, because of our transgressions. When we know that we have to repent because He died because of us. But He did that willingly. He loved us so much that He came to this world, the Bible says, to offer Himself as a sacrifice. So you and I don't have to go through this punishment. He took it already. So there's no need for you and I to take punishment. No need at all. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are where? In Christ Jesus. So if you haven't obeyed the gospel and you want to believe, if you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, if you want to repent of your sins, if you want to confess Him before men, and you can do that today, if you want to be baptized to wash away your sins, we have all fallen short. We have all sinned, basically. So if you want to repent, confess, and be baptized, you can do that today. Today we have the bathtub back here. We'll fill it up with water, and you obey the gospel of Christ today. Okay, if you want to do that, you can do that right now as together we stand and sing.